Curiously, you read a lot about drought and weather extremes. Some people in Washington are saying, well, all this is because of man-made global warming, right? We see that all the time. History shows that, no, it's not, again, about man-made global warming. The greenhouse gas theory and the UN models that come out of the UN Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change and our own government, and they're very unreliable, not even close to what actual temperatures, much less actual sea levels are. And there may be item 7, other shorter cycles, but in time we'll probably update the RC theory. This is the theory that I developed back in April and May of 07 that has allowed me to make the predictions I have, and here are some of those. This is a laundry list of major climate predictions made based on the RC theory. Back then, I notified the White House, and I just finished a project for them out of the Vice President's office. We had a big announcement in 04. Karl Rove got me in with the President on his presentation at NASA headquarters to announce a grand new space program. We all know what happened with that. But if you look at this list, these are major climate predictions that were made based on the RC theory. The Space and Science Research Corporation, according to public records anyway, has the best major climate prediction record in the United States. Certainly better than UN, certainly better than any US government agency. And as far as we can tell, and Dr. Swire and I have been trying to find anyone else that has an organization that's doing this kind of thing, it looks like the RC theory is the best we've got going right now. If I can find someone with a better theory and a better prediction rate, I'm going to finally end up retiring like I tried to do back in 06. But right now, this is the best we've got going. In our global climate report, you will find that we're going to give you a prediction of the future. But if any time we find that this theory is starting to fail, the data is not showing the predictive reliability we want, we'll be the first to tell you. There'll be no cover-up, no deception. We're going to tell you right away, hey, the theory stopped working. We don't know why or whatever, but we'll tell you the truth. The thing that is most consistent in the last 7 years is the truth. We only give you the truth. We only give you the facts. No deception, no smoke and mirrors. Item 7 is interesting. One can say, well, you know, okay, so maybe you've got some good theory on the climate, but what do you mean talking about earthquakes and volcanoes at the same time? This is really shocking information. Even today, I have a tough time appreciating what's going on because we are so intimately tied to solar cycles and the sun's behavior, not just day and night, not just seasons, but the entire planet is tied to what the sun is doing. What we know with great certainty is that the worst earthquakes and the worst volcanoes occur at the very bottom of these solar hibernations, the bottom of these cold cycles, the bottom of the 206-year cycle. We should be expecting and we should be planning on the worst. History shows the last time we had a solar hibernation back in the 1800s, we had the worst ever recorded earthquakes and volcanoes on this planet. And we'll get into those more. My book, Cold Sun, I've shown you a few comments up here from scientists around the world. It has been acclaimed internationally. The cold sun is basically telling us the sun is no longer going to warm us like it used to. It's going to cut back on its energy. It's going to make it colder, effectively so. I want to thank my wife for the last comment. Talk about epiphanies. When I told my wife what I had discovered, she gave me this look that she used to give to her elementary students who dog just ate the homework. And she's been hanging in there with me ever since. So honey, you have my love and thanks. But I do want you to come up with a stronger statement so I can, you know, improve that slide. The Global Climate Status Report, again, we've talked about it. This is what keeps the lights on in the company. Please tell your friends and family, you can go online and get it. You can get a printed copy ordered. But it tells you the truth about the climate and what's happening with it. We find that these cycles are so predictable, you go back in time and you find out they're almost, well, they're well over 90% reliable, let me put it that way. That compares with the CO2 theory, the greenhouse gas theory, and the UN models that come out of the UN Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. And here are some scientists who have also looked at it, and here's what they've said about the Global Climate Status Report. I'm going to go quickly through these. I've got a poster up here, you can read some of that. I've actually got Dr. Swire's comment in here. If anyone, especially in the media or government, wants to know the climate status of our planet, there's only one reliable source, the Global Climate Status Report. Our group of scientists that put this together have tried to give you the best that we can. We have very little funding to do so. We're doing the best we can, but we still think the Global Climate Status Report is the best document out there today. Please tell your friends and family, this is the one you go to. And if you ever need anything else, send us an email. We'll work on it. An ominous solar hibernation has begun. How do we know this? We're going to talk about that and explain why. First off, of the family of cycles we talk about in the RC theory, the most powerful, the most important is the big one, the 206-year cycle. The longer the cycle is, the more powerful it is, the more impact it has on the planet's climate. The 206-year cycle has reversed from warming to cooling, and that's what is causing the solar hibernation. Curiously, you read a lot about drought and weather extremes. Some people in Washington are saying, well, all this is because of man-made global warming, right? We see that all the time. History shows that, no, it's not, again, about man-made global warming. History of these solar cycles, however, shows you that's exactly what we should be expecting during the transition. When you transition from a very warm to a very cold period, the Earth, the oceans, the mantle, the atmosphere, they all react accordingly. And that literally shakes the planet. Literally shakes the planet. This picture, or this chart, is important because it identifies some things about solar cycles. It's a very well-known chart for those who've studied man-made global warming or climate change at all. This is probably one of the most familiar charts. It shows the Dalton minimum and the Maunder minimum. The names for these minimums are, first off, it's a minimum of solar activity or a solar hibernation. You can call it a solar minimum or a solar hibernation, same thing. Dr. Dalton, the father of the atomic theory, the model of the atom, took weather readings. So did Maunder back in his era. These two different eras were given the names of those distinguished scientists and weather monitorers. If you look at the modern maximum, that's where we just came out of. You can see the downslope on the far right of the chart. That's where we're heading. We're heading there rapidly. I'm going to show you another chart on that. The current minimum we're heading into hasn't been named yet, but at some point the physics community will get together and they'll name one. No, please, thank you. I've had many people say, oh, it should be the Casey minimum. I think it should be the Landscheidt minimum. He was a distinguished researcher long before me. The only other one I would like to see it named for is Dr. John Eddy, who did some of the best work on solar cycles, one of those two. However, if I were anyone who's going to get named for this next cycle, I would probably turn it down. This is not going to be a pleasant time. A lot of people are going to suffer. A lot of people are going to die. You don't want your name associated with it. That's my opinion. So what is the status of the climate with regard to this hibernation, and how do we know there is a hibernation? Ladies and gentlemen, in the far right of this chart, you can see the steepest drop in global temperatures in the last 100 years. If you look at it closer, you can see on other charts that 17 or 18 year period where we've had no global warming. It actually flattens out when you look at it in a smaller scale. But the trend is what we do at the SSRC. We don't look at 1 year or even a few years. We look at the big picture, the big trend, because that's what tells us whether climate's going to change. Curiously, once it became widely recognized that global warming had either ended or there wasn't any, the so-called pause was in place, the warmest community said, well, you actually need 9 years of straight line, no growth before we know anything's happening. Then it went to 12 years. And when we got to 12 years, they said, well, you really need 14 years. When it got to 14 years, they said, no, it's got to be at least 16 years. This goalpost keeps moving, ladies and gentlemen. They will never be happy with recognizing the facts and the truth that climate has changed. However, when they came out with their report, their first report at the UN in 1990, they only had 3 years of actual global warming. And all of a sudden, global warming was real. So you can see the hypocrisy. It's rampant. This is a very important chart. Probably very few people on the planet have ever seen it. But this is the one I consider the most important, because it tells you, again, if the oceans are cooling, everything else is going to follow. And the oceans have been cooling. They don't cool all at the same time. Likewise, the atmosphere. Likewise, between North and South Hemisphere. The rates are different. The scales are different. The time frames are different. But here you can see, since 2003, for 11 years, the oceans have been cooling. Nothing in Washington will change that. This one is very striking. This is the Pacific Decadal Oscillation for the last 30 years. I have another chart that shows it for 100 years. The Pacific has been cooling for at least 30 years and is now heading toward the bottom of its cycle, which will last for another 20 years at least. Ladies and gentlemen, the reason we don't hear a lot about actual measurements of sea level rise in California and Washington is because sea level is dropping in Washington and California and Oregon. The Pacific is getting colder. Their sea levels have been dropping for years. I'm talking tidal gauge measurements, the only actual measurements we can actually go out and verify. Sea levels are still rising on the Atlantic. Why is that? Because we have only just now passed the peak of warming in the Atlantic. They should be rising, but they're going to start dropping rapidly. So again, the planet is going to get colder and the sea is going to lead the way. Here's the Atlantic cycle. The Atlantic Multidecadal Oscillation, or AMO, much bigger cycle, more powerful cycle. We sent out a press release a few months ago showing in the top right that that cycle has now peaked. It may stay there for a few years, but it will drop, and precipitously so. And when the PDO and the AMO are both in cold phase at the same time, ladies and gentlemen, the Northern Hemisphere will be a very cold place. Another signal that a solar hibernation is in place. This chart is also important. We hear a lot about Arctic sea ice melting. We hear a lot about the Antarctic melting. It's all bogus. As you can see from the blue line in the bottom right of the chart, sure enough, the Arctic sea ice decline was fairly strong right up until 2003. At the same time, global ocean temperatures started to drop. Sea ice in the Arctic started to stabilize. It's bottomed out. As you can see, it's gone up and down ever since. It's still going up right now. But that cycle is changing over. Look at the Antarctic, the red line above it. Very dramatic. About 2003, it began a very rapid growth. We're now seeing the largest sea ice growth ever recorded in the Antarctic. When you combine the two, we're now seeing a total sea ice number that we've never seen before in recorded history. Don't let anyone tell you that sea ice is a problem. By the way, when it melts, what happens to sea level? Nothing.